Well, hello there. Now, how did I manage to print a helmet this big on this printer? The printer is a Flashforge Adventurer 3 with a build size of 150 mm cubed. This helmet is a lot bigger. With some cutting and a lot of post-processing, it was no trouble at all. Welcome to the cellar. As you might have figured out, I am the nerd. My name is Fredrik, and in this video, I will show you exactly how I did it. Let's go! After downloading this great model made by JTM, links in the description of course, I opened it in Flashprint. It's obviously way too big, so I need to do some cutting. I start by splitting it in half, front to back, and I chose to keep the parts in place to make it easier on myself. I selected both pieces again and did a horizontal cut straight through the center. Select all pieces again, and two more vertical cuts are to be made. One a bit towards the back, and the other one a bit towards the front. Now that's most of the cutting done. Now I'll save it like it is, so I can reload it at a later stage. Just make sure not to overwrite this file as you do changes from now on. Then I remove everything but one of the bottom halves. I select them all and I rotate them to make them print easier and place them on the build plate. I like to send them all to the platform and center to get a good starting point. Platform center. Platform center. Platform center. Once they are all on the build plate and placed in the center, I select them one by one and I rotate and I move them around. This is, well, I'm a little bit fiddly, but you'll soon get the hang of it and make them all fit. Then it's time to add some supports. On these bottom halves I have to add supports because there are quite a few overhangs. With that out of the way, it's time to start slicing. I'm printing with a 0.6 nozzle, 0.4 layer height and 3 walls. No raft, but on the top halves I did use a brim. I did not do that on the bottom halves, even if I'm doing so in this video. So I slice away and preview the slicing. That looks alright. So we send it to the printer and wait 9 hours until the parts are done. I look decent enough. Now to remove the supports. You always need to be careful when removing supports. Or, you always need to remove the supports. But what do you know? The pieces actually fit together. Now when I printed the second part for the bottom half, I ran into a slight issue. That gap, it's not supposed to be there. Some major layer shift. Well, well, print again. Back in Flashprint, I reopened the saved file from earlier, making sure not to save when prompted. I remove all but one of the top halves, and here I show you how I place the different parts. On platform center, and the front third really needs supports. There are some nasty overhangs, and the top I'm not sure it would have printed nicely without the supports. The second part is best printed rotated 90 degrees on the x-axis. It saves a lot of time and filament as no supports now are needed. Though there is a tiny overhang here, so just to play it safe I flipped it around and made the overhang go on the inside of the helmet. Now to the back part. This part is best split again. I cut it in two close to the line you can see going down back there. Well, I try to align it as closely as possible. No, not that way, the other way. Frederick, come on, yeah, that's it. There you go. I make my cut. And then I rotate the two parts to make them print as nicely as possible. Now, this biggest part doesn't need supports. You could add some to the smallest one if you feel inclined to do so. I played it safe and printed the small one with support, and both of these with a brim as well. After all of this half was printed, I did it again to the other half. With all the parts printed and done, it's time to head to the workshop. Sanding the edges, trimming a little bit of the brims and some bumps, taping them into position, and then using a soldering iron to weld them together. This was my first attempt at this technique, so I was a little bit nervous, but it wasn't hard at all. I took the time needed and I tried to go a bit heavy on the inside and quite light on the outside. Now there's quite a bit of sanding, taping and welding. And do notice there is a fan sucking the air and the fumes out to the outside. This fan is big enough for brewing beer, but I do think I need a better solution for fumes in the future. Now, I'm quite surprised at how strong the weld is, but then again, it is melted plastic after all. So go heavy on the inside, and a lighter touch on the outside. Rinse and repeat, or sand and repeat, until it's all done. When it's all welded, I try it on for a fit, and as you can see, I'm rather pleased. Then I started sanding, and sanding, and sanding. And sanding, and sanding, and sanding. And do remember to stay hydrated. A quick wipe down with a wet cloth before applying the magic that is this plastic filler. This was my first time trying this stuff, so I wasn't quite sure what to expect when opening it. And as you can see, I had to do some serious thinking to figure out how much 2% actually is. So it was 9.8 grams of the stuff plus 0.2 grams of hardener, mixed and applied to the welded helmet. Thoroughly mixed. Now it dries in 15 minutes, so I worked in small batches, basically doing one section at a time before mixing a new batch. As soon as I was done with the back of the helmet, the flattest parts, I started sanding, and I quickly got the nerves to try out the orbital sander. I know you shouldn't use powered sanders on 3D printed parts, but I figured it was worth a shot with this filler applied. I started slowly but quickly up to speed, and it worked like a dream, making my job a lot easier. Some sanding still had to be done manually though. Now we get into the finer details. I used my finger to get into all the nooks and crannies with this stuff, making sure to cover every surface properly to get rid of any layer lines. Remember, I did print it with a 0.4mm layer height. After some sanding of the finer detailed areas, it was on to the plastic primer. Outside and inside, and letting it dry overnight. The next day I got some help from my son painting, but sadly I didn't remember to film the two of us. Minding a 6-year-old and working with spray paint at the same time was more than enough, I guess. But we did get the outside black, and a few hours later I was back to do the inside. A few touch-ups on the outside as well, and being impatient, a heating gun really speeds up the time paint takes to dry. Then it's time for the silver. A lot of masking out details, a little bit of cutting and peeling off the tape, and adding some plastic to cover the larger surfaces. And we are golden, or should I say silvery. As soon as the chrome paint had dried, or rather a little bit sooner, it was time to unpeel the masking. Well, look at that. I am happy with that. Look at the details. Of course, there are spots I'll do better next time, but I'm pleased. Then it's time to move on to the inside. I need to mask off the outside and cover the inside with the paint my son decided we just had to buy. And look at that pink gold. Isn't it stunning? I quickly realized my masking game wasn't on target, so I had to go back with the black paint to cover up some areas of overspray. Then a few rounds with the clear lacquer to finish it all off, and the helmet is getting close to done. And look at that pink gold inside, I'm loving it. But of course, the inside needs to be finished off as well. And this is where I messed up a little bit. I added even more lacquer to the front of the helmet, but not to the back. That gave the back a bit of a dull appearance from the mist of the spray. But fortunately, it's not too bad. I can live with it. And as always, remember to clear out your spray can when you're done using it. Now, the only thing remaining is adding some padding to the insides. The printer is quite small, but this helmet is quite large. Way too large for my head without padding. And even larger for my son, who is the one who will be using the helmet. I'm using some pieces of an old mattress to make the cushions. And of course, I have to try it on for fit. I'm using some Velcro tape to fasten the cushions to the helmet and make them replaceable, so that we can have one set of cushions for my son and another set for me. The Velcro is attached to both the helmet and the pieces of foam. That's the last bit, and the helmet is done. And for a final touch, there's a matching lightsaber. More on that in another video.